A historic moment, a celebration. Welcome, everyone. I'm Ana Cabrera. Thank you for joining us. The soon-to-be Supreme Court Justice, Judge Ketanji Brown Jackson, speaking for the first time since she was confirmed in the White House, marking this achievement, the first Black woman in the court's 233-year history. With us now, CNN senior White House correspondent Phil Mattingly, CNN senior legal analyst Laura Coates, and CNN legal analyst Joe Biskupic. And Laura, this was an emotional and powerful speech. You said it took 233 years, that is, but we've made it.
First of all, Ana, I'm not crying, you're crying. If anyone should see the tears fall, but I am extraordinarily emotional about this, and I can understand every moment, every breath, every pause that she took when she concluded and said that it took her family but one generation to go from segregation to the Supreme Court. I am the daughter of the Jim Crow South. My mother at segregated schools in North Carolina, my father in Worcester, Massachusetts, where Jim Crow found a wingspan nonetheless. And to have and see this moment is unbelievably breathtaking for me. And I know many people will make these comments and they'll say, well, her presence won't change the composition of the court because she's replacing and succeeding somebody who has a similar ideology. But let me tell you, if you did not notice and understand the full breadth of how she will change the discussion on the Supreme Court, bringing the gift that her ancestors have given her, as she quoted Maya Angelou, this is a woman who understood the assignment, understood all that brought her here, and understood what it took for a Black woman to now be the 116th Supreme Court confirmed justice to the court. And I can tell you, as a mother, as a Black woman, as an attorney, as a scholar of history, I cannot tell you how my heart and my soul is bursting, because for the first time, I see myself.
And she talked about how that was not lost on her and the great responsibility she feels in representing so much more than herself, more than the country. It's such a deep feeling that, you know, she is carrying forward. She won't take the bench, however, for a few more months. Joan, explain why and what happens next.
Sure. Good to be with you, Ana. And she really did own this moment. And you can see her great sense of rhetoric. She will probably bring that into her discussions with her fellow colleagues. She knows how to make her case in every way. What she will do, though, she will not be able to make her case yet until the end of June or July, because Stephen Breyer, whom she's succeeding, is still serving out the 21-22 term. Lots of big cases that he'll be resolving, and abortion rights and gun control and many other momentous decisions are expected. But she will then take the oath of office, her constitutional oath and judicial oath, at the end of June or July when this term finishes up. And then, Ana, starting right away, she'll probably handle several emergency petitions that will come in over the summer. But the big next time we will see her in person on any kind of national stage will be at the Supreme Court on the first Monday in October when the new session starts. And what will then come before the court that she will have a hand in will be major voting rights cases that are already on their calendar, an important test of racial affirmative action in higher education from both the University of North Carolina and Harvard. She has already said she will sit out the Harvard case because she's currently a member of the Harvard Board of Overseers. And then a major case involving gay rights in America. As you know, in 2015, the Supreme Court said that the Constitution gives same-sex couples a right to marry, but there are so many other issues around that, including retailers in the case that's coming up, a woman who has a website that handles marriages and doesn't want to serve same-sex couples for their marriages. And that will be tested as a free speech, religious liberty, gay rights case. So she will have plenty of important matters to be part of, but it won't start officially until she takes her oath at the end of June or early July. And just one last thing. She's currently sitting on the U.S. Court of Appeals for the District of Columbia Circuit, and she will continue in that responsibility for a few more weeks. Anna.
I want to bring in Phil Mattingly as well, because we heard from President Biden, Phil. He called this a moment of real change in America. And in many ways, this was a legacy moment for President Biden as well. How important was this for the president and his party?
Yeah, I don't think you can overstate it in terms of the president, as in just the individual President Biden. Obviously, during the campaign, making the pledge to appoint the first African-American woman, coming through on that pledge. But I think more broadly, any president, the opportunity to put their own personal stamp on the court is huge. It is legacy no matter what. You look at the age of Ketanji Brown Jackson, you look at how long she will likely be on the court, the role she will play there despite the current ideological makeup of the court. She will always be associated with President Biden. I think that matters a lot. In terms of for the party, I think more than anything else, it's a couple of things. It's delivering on a promise. It's delivering on a promise to a very key constituency for the Democratic Party. But more than that, I think the process here matters. It probably doesn't get as much attention. The judge's remarks were rather extraordinary in terms of leaning into this moment and what it means. But the process to get here over the course of 42 days from the nomination to the confirmation, with a team of individuals from the president, obviously former Senate Judiciary Committee Chairman, his chief of staff, Ron Klain, who's been through a number of these nominations, the White House counsel, Dana Remus. Also, you heard Judge Jackson list off a team of names, all of whom were critical during this process, their legislative affairs team, her outside team, and making it, despite some fireworks at those hearings, a rather seamless process, and a process that secured the votes of three Republicans, which the president made sure to shout out. I think that matters. Competency is what the president ran on. Competency is what White House officials believe they delivered during this process. And without question, they delivered a historic moment for his administration and his legacy.
Let's discuss with CNN political commentator Keisha Lance Bottoms, who was there today at that White House event, and CNN legal analyst Elliot Williams. Mayor, just describe the atmosphere. What was that like to be there?
It was very celebratory, and it was like a family reunion of sorts, because we haven't had many of these large gatherings at the White House. There were people there from all over the country representing all groups and governments across the country, and it really looked and felt like America, and it was just a wonderful day. And as she spoke, there were many people who had tears in their eyes. She quoted Maya Angelou from Still I Rise, "Bringing the gifts that my ancestors gave, I am the dream and the hope of the slave." She talked about being one generation removed from segregation, and to watch her next to President Biden and Vice President Harris it was just a moment that I will always remember, and I'm so glad that so many people had an opportunity to witness it.
Yeah, that first line of her remarks when she said, "First, I want to thank God who delivered me as promised," certainly stood out to me. Elliot, let me come to you with, you know, we heard from the president. He said that, you know, what Judge Jackson endured, using his words, during the confirmation hearings amounts to verbal abuse. Republicans complain about how Kavanaugh was treated, but was this different?
You know, look, the entire process of selecting judicial nominees is just broken and tainted. Look, Victor, in the last day, Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell has acknowledged that he may not even bring up any future nominees if he's majority leader again. There's plenty of time to fight about how tainted and dirty the process is. Today, frankly, should be a day of joy for all Americans. Think about not just the black boys and girls who are seeing Ketanji Brown Jackson, but the white kids who are now growing up in a world where a Supreme Court justice can be a black woman. That's their framing and their notion of what success and the Supreme Court looks like. So, it's a horrible process now. Consider that she only got three Republicans supporting her, whereas, you know, just a couple of years ago, John Roberts had 22 Democrats supporting him. In the last several years, it's just gotten ugly and hideous and partisan. She was able to be the best and sort of rise up and be someone that all Americans, even Republicans, should be proud of today.